In this video, based on question 2 from the 2023 AP Bio exam, we'll start by looking at how differing CO2 levels affect mitochondrial density in plant cells. Then we'll look at a data set provided by the College Board and graph that data into a beautiful bar chart, including error bars. We'll look at environment-genotype interaction and how it affects phenotype. And then we will connect solidly with a curve thrown at us by the College Board, which involves non-nuclear inheritance in plants. Are you ready for AP Bio Review? Before we start, I want to let you know that we have a fabulous guide for writing FRQs, and you can download it by going to apbiosuccess.com/FRQs. 2023 Question 2 Introduction. I'll read it for you, but you should also read it on your own copy of the FRQ, which you can download from the College Board's website. The link is in the description. Elevated levels of CO2 increase the rate of photosynthesis and growth in plants. Scientists studying the mechanisms involved in these increases examined a variety of species and found that when the plants were exposed to elevated levels of CO2, there is an increase in the number of chloroplasts per cell. To investigate whether the elevated levels of CO2 have a similar effect on the number of mitochondria in plant cells, the scientists then selected 6 of these species to quantify the number of mitochondria per cell when the plants were exposed to both normal and elevated levels of CO2. That's shown in Table 1, which is right here. To describe the role of the inner mitochondrial membrane in cellular respiration, pause the video, answer the question, hit play when you're ready to see my response. Here's the answer. It, the inner mitochondrial membrane, contains the enzymes for the electron transport chain, the proton pumps for creating a proton gradient, and ATP synthase, which produces most of cellular respiration's ATP through chemiosmosis. You should also be looking at the scoring guide, which you can download from the College Board's website, and see how your answer compares. I probably wrote too much. Here's a diagram showing the mitochondria. Here's the intermembrane space, the outer membrane, and the inner mitochondrial membrane. And you can see that here are the proton pumps. Here are the various proteins that are part of the mitochondrial electron transport chain. Here's ATP synthase, all of the things that I described above. Question 2B, using the template in the space provided for your response, construct an appropriately labeled graph that represents the data in Table 1. Grab a piece of graph paper, draw your graph. When you're ready to see mine, go ahead and press play. If you know how to do this, then just skip ahead, compare your answer to mine, or you can compare your answer to what's shown in the scoring guide from the College Board. I'll walk you through the various steps. What the College Board is looking for is what I listed over here. Axes that are appropriately labeled, but needed to be a bar graph. Data points and error bars for that bar graph needed to be correctly plotted, and all 6 species graphed. Let's jump to the end. Why does this have to be a bar graph? It's because our independent variable is 6 different species. And when you have different categories, A versus B versus C, you use a bar graph. If we had a single continuous variable, something like temperature, then we'd use an XY graph and we'd draw a line connecting the data points and we could see trends and things like that. But in this case, using a bar graph will allow us to see how each species responds to high versus low CO2 levels side by side. So how do you set this thing up? You've got these 6 species and you're comparing them. And in that situation, that's almost always going to go over here on your x-axis. In other words, that's your independent variable. The dependent variable is the number of mitochondria that you'll see at both normal CO2 levels or elevated CO2 levels. So that's going to go on your y-axis. That's your dependent variable. How do you set up the scale? Well, over here, there are 6 species, so just leave yourself enough room. You'll need to draw 2 bars for each species because there are 2 columns over here. And in terms of your y-axis scale, I'm looking over here and I'm seeing that the biggest value is 2.5. 4, and that's pretty convenient. So I'm just going to set every line to be worth 0.10, and that'll take me all the way up to 3. We're going to start with species number 1. I'm looking at the value on the table for species 1. At normal CO2 levels, the value is 1.0 plus or minus 0.10. How do you do that? Well, you find 1.0 over here. That's your bar. And then your error bar is 0.1 above or 0.1 below. Just draw a horizontal line, another horizontal line, and connect them. So we've plotted our first data point. Now we're going to draw the second data point, and that value is 1.6 at elevated CO2 levels. So I'm finding 1.6 over here. I'm going to draw my bar, and my error bar is again 0.1. So 0.1 above, 0.1 below. Draw my line and draw my horizontal lines. But now I have to differentiate between normal CO2 levels and elevated CO2 levels. And how I'm going to do that is by creating a key. So normal CO2 levels, I'm going to leave the bars blank. For elevated CO2 levels, I'm going to put these little hash marks. So I've completed the data for species 1. And now I need to do that 5 more times for species 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. They're shown over here. For each one, I'm plotting the data correctly and I'm drawing in error bars. And when I'm done, just to be safe, you'll see that this isn't the case with the College Board scoring guide, but I'm going to put a title: average number of mitochondria in plants exposed to normal and elevated CO2 concentrations. If you draw a graph like this, you'll get full credit. Those are the steps. You can do it. Question 2, part C. Based on the data in Table 1, describe the relationship between the level of CO2 and the average number of mitochondria per unit area of a cell. Go ahead and do that. When you're ready, hit play and see my answer. Here's the answer. As the CO2 level goes up, the average number of mitochondria per cell increases. You see that in every species. And what you can see from the graph that you just drew is that it's a significant difference in every single species. This question didn't require you to grapple with that concept, but remember, if the error bars don't overlap, then the difference is significant. If they do overlap, that means that it's not a significant difference. If you want to crush it on this year's AP Bio exam, then you're going to have to write great responses on the FRQ portion of the exam. It's half of your score. Where can you learn how to do that? On learn-biology.com with our enhanced practice FRQs. You read a prompt, you type in your response, we give you feedback telling you about your answer's strengths and weaknesses. If you need help, you can ask for a hint. If you're really stuck, you can study a sample answer. We have dozens of practice FRQs, and this is the kind of practice and feedback that'll lead you to crush it on this year's AP Bio exam. So here's your plan. Go to learn-biology.com, sign up, use our enhanced practice FRQs to get the practice you need to succeed. Question 2D, parts 1 and 2. The leaves of a particular plant species are typically green, but scientists notice a plant in which the leaves have white stripes. They determine that the stripes result from a mutation in mitochondrial DNA that interferes with the development of chloroplasts. The scientists cross plants using pollen from the plant with white striped leaves and ovules from a plant with green leaves. Your job is twofold. You're to predict the phenotypes of the leaves of offspring produced from this cross, and then provide reasoning to justify your prediction. I want you to pause the video, go ahead and do those two things. First, we'll look at the prediction, and then I'll spend more time on the justification. Go ahead, pause, write, and then hit play to see my answer. Here's the correct prediction. All the leaves will be green. To see why, we need to look a little bit at non-nuclear inheritance. You have probably learned in your course about non-nuclear inheritance in animals. In animals, the non-nuclear inheritance involves mitochondria, and all mitochondria come from the egg. They don't come from the sperm. Here's a sperm, Here's its nucleus. And the sperm has mitochondria, but they're at this front part of the tail. During fertilization, the egg and the sperm fuse. The nuclear material from the sperm will enter the egg, but no mitochondria from the sperm will enter the egg. In other words, all of the mitochondria of the offspring derive from the mother. You're a little bit more closely related to your mom because you have her mitochondrial DNA than your dad because you don't have any of his mitochondrial DNA. The thing that was difficult about this question is that it wasn't about non-nuclear inheritance in animals, which most AP Bio students are familiar with. It was about non-nuclear inheritance in plants, which is not exactly a side topic. It's part of the curriculum, but if there's a thing that your teacher might not have covered, this would have been it. And the basic idea is that in plants, all the mitochondria and the chloroplast, so both of those organelles that contain DNA, come from the ovule, the egg. Going into plant reproduction in detail is a little bit beyond the scope of an AP Bio course, but there's pollen and there are ovules, and they're both haploid. So they're the equivalent, essentially, of the egg and the sperm in animals, but they're more complex. But all you need to know is that the ovule within the ovary is providing the mitochondria and the chloroplast. The pollen, which fertilizes the ovule to create a diploid zygote, that brings nuclear DNA, it brings nuclear chromosomes, but it's not bringing in any mitochondria or chloroplast. So with all of that in mind, let's take a look at the justification for this prediction. The leaves of the offspring from this cross will be completely green without stripes. But that's because the pollen was from the plant with the white striped leaves, and the ovules were for a plant with green leaves. And the justification is as follows. The pollen is from the plant with the white striped leaves. The pollen doesn't carry the mitochondrial genes. Therefore, none of the mutated mitochondrial genes that cause this phenotype will pass to the ovum, the egg, and all the leaves will be green. It's not that difficult a question. You just needed to know this aspect of plant non-nuclear inheritance. Question 2, part D, part 3, explain why plants with the same genotype are able to differ in the structure and or number of certain organelles in response to changes in atmospheric levels of CO2. Pause the video, answer the question. When you're ready to see the answer, hit play. Here's the answer. This is an example of a genotype-environment interaction during which changes to the environment, such as the level of CO2, affect the expression of different genes, such as those in mitochondria and chloroplasts. That alters the phenotype, such as the numbers of mitochondria and chloroplasts. Why do I have a picture of a hydrangea down here below? Because hydrangeas are a very clear example and very widely used example of genotype environment interaction. If hydrangeas are grown in acidic soil, they produce this beautiful purple color. And if they're grown in alkaline soil, they produce this beautiful red color. And gardeners who are knowledgeable about that stuff will alter the environment in order to change the phenotype through this genotype environment interaction. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. Studying past FRQs, what you're doing now, is a brilliant way to get yourself ready for future FRQs, but you have to prepare yourself for those future FRQs, which won't exactly be like the ones in the past. So let's go beyond what was in this exact question and extend things a little bit. You need to know about cellular respiration. In this question, you were asked about the function of the inner mitochondrial membrane, but you need to know the whole thing. You need to know about glycolysis, the link reaction, the Krebs cycle, and the electron transport chain. And of course, the big picture is that glycolysis, the link reaction, and Krebs are taking glucose and its byproducts, and they're oxidizing them to convert NAD plus and FAD into NADH and FADH2. These are the mobile electron carriers that are used during cellular respiration. In the last phase of cellular respiration, over here, the electron transport chain and chemiosmosis, what happens is that all of that NADH and FADH2 are oxidized, stripped of their energetic electrons. That powers the electron transport chain, that creates a proton gradient, and that powers chemiosmosis. You gotta know the whole thing. So be ready for that as you prepare for the next set of FRQs. Another takeaway from question two, something you should study to get prepared for the next FRQs that you'll be facing, has to do with genotype-environment interaction. The idea is that factors in the environment influence gene expression, leading to variation in phenotype within a population. And note that this is not some weird exception relating to hydrangeas. This is the norm. This is a huge part of what variation is all about. Example one does have to do with hydrangeas. It's a very easy and obvious example. Here's another cool looking one. In mammals, certain mammals, you have cells that have the same genes throughout the body, and that relates to an important principle, which is that all cells have the same genes. But why is this dark over here? That's because in these regions that are in the extremities, the cells develop at a cooler temperature, and that allows for the expression of genes that lead to the laying down of dark pigment, usually melanin. That's a genotype-environment interaction. They are all over the place. Other examples include height and weight in humans, hugely influenced by the environment. Skin color changes in humans in relationship to sun exposure, which happens seasonally all around the globe. And in Unit 5, we learn that in many reptiles, the sex is determined by the temperature at which the organism develops. So that's, again, another hugely impactful environment genotype interaction leading to variation in phenotype. And here's another takeaway that has to do with non-nuclear inheritance, and the extension that you didn't have to grapple with is something like this. You might see a pedigree chart and it wouldn't be labeled maternal inheritance, but you'd see this pattern and you'd have to know, something really curious. The mom is passing on this condition to all of her children, but here's a male and he doesn't pass it on to any of his children. It's always the mother passing it on to all of her children. And that kind of inheritance pattern, if you see a pedigree pattern like this, then you know that it's non-nuclear inheritance. It's mitochondrial inheritance, and that's derived solely from the mother. Again, I want to emphasize that studying past FRQs, fabulous, but you need as much feedback and as many new stimuli as you can get. And the best place to get those is on learn-biology.com, where we have enhanced practice FRQs with AI feedback. You'll get prompts, you'll type in your answer, and you will have feedback that's given to you by an AI that's comparing your answer with a sample answer. It's been extensively tested. It works great. It's going to make you into a great FRQ writer, and you can get it at learn-biology.com. For right now, your next moves for success are to sign up for learn-biology.com, the website that guarantees your success, and to continue your journey towards a 5 on the AP Bio exam by watching this next video. Thanks.